acceleration is one of the most important concepts in physics. Understanding it allows a firm grip on the deepest law of mechanics, Newton's second law of motion, F equals ma. This is big. Acceleration has to be clear. But acceleration is tricky. The trickiness is evident upon realizing that an object's acceleration has nothing to do with that object's velocity, but it has everything to do with that object's change in velocity. Conceptually, acceleration is a measure of how quickly velocity changes. An athlete who can move at high velocity is said to be fast, but an athlete who can accelerate well is said to be quick. Being fast and being quick are two very different attributes. Notice that you don't have to be fast to be quick. A housefly can't go very fast, but it's amazingly quick. It can really accelerate. And you don't have to be quick to be fast. A jet fighter is not nearly as quick as a housefly, but it can go much faster. Here comes the definition of acceleration. Acceleration, little a vector, is defined as change in velocity divided by the corresponding elapsed time. That is, it's delta v vector divided by delta t. Before applying this definition in several examples, let's just explore it a bit. We've seen this mathematical structure before, delta something divided by delta t. This is the rate of change operator that we saw in RP6. This definition of acceleration is telling us that acceleration is the rate of change of velocity. That's very helpful. Remember this. Acceleration is the rate of change of velocity. And notice something tricky. Velocity itself is a rate of change. That's right. We define velocity to be the rate of change of position. So acceleration is the rate of change of something that is itself a rate of change. Acceleration is the rate of change of a rate of change. No wonder it's a difficult concept. Our mathematical definition also tells us acceleration's units of measurement. Since the numerator is a difference between two velocities, its units must be meters per second. And since the denominator is a difference between two times, its units must be seconds. Altogether, then, the units of acceleration must be meters divided by seconds divided by seconds. Those seconds don't cancel, by the way. Check your math. That's meters per second per second. Acceleration is defined as delta v vector divided by delta t, meters per second per second. Let's do an example to get a good feel for this. As in past episodes, we'll look at Usain Bolt's legendary 100-meter dash at the 2008 Beijing Olympics. Bolt didn't get out of the blocks particularly quickly, but he did have terrific acceleration after that. Careful measurement of his run shows that he reached a maximum velocity of plus 12.2 meters per second after just about 5.5 seconds. Let's use these numbers and units to determine Bolt's acceleration. Acceleration is defined as delta v vector divided by delta t. So little a vector equals v vector sub 2 minus v vector sub 1 divided by t sub 2 minus t sub 1. That's plus 12.2 meters per second minus 0 divided by 5.5 seconds minus 0. Usain Bolt's acceleration during the first 5 or so seconds of that 100-meter dash was plus 12.2 meters per second divided by 5.5 seconds. That equals about 2.2 meters per second per second. let each of those words mean something to you. Bolt's velocity increased by 2.2 meters per second each second during the first 5.5 seconds of his sprint. Can this be strictly true? No. What we actually have computed is Bolt's average acceleration during those first 5 or so seconds. Our definition needs to be modified just a little bit. Average acceleration, A sub AV, equals delta V vector divided by delta T. However, in radical physics, we're not going to worry about the distinction between average acceleration and instantaneous acceleration. It won't be necessary because the accelerations that we'll consider won't be changing. If A doesn't change, then average A is the same as instantaneous A. Usain Bolt's acceleration during his first 5.5 seconds was plus 2.2 meters per second per second. Consider those units carefully. Meters per second per second will always be our units of acceleration. The definition of acceleration demands it. Other distance and time units can be used, of course. Feet per second makes sense. So does miles per hour per second. But we'll stick with meters per second. Get used to those units. Evidently, 2.2 meters per second is excellent sprinting acceleration. But I'll do my best to remember that 1 meter per second is common walking startup acceleration. That's going from rest to a brisk 1 meter per second walk in just 1 second. By the way, we can use a mathematical shorthand for this unit. A meter divided by a second divided by a second is mathematically equivalent to a meter divided by a second times a second. That's a meter divided by a second squared. But look at that denominator. What is a square second? No one knows conceptually what a square second is. No one can visualize it the way you can visualize a square meter, say. At best, a square second is just a mathematical shorthand for a second times a second. At worst, it is a code whose meaning is easily forgotten. I strongly recommend that you express acceleration in meters per second, not meters per second squared, until you're really certain that you understand acceleration conceptually. To that end, let's do another example. A very, very quick sports car can go from 0 to 30 meters per second in 3 seconds. We start with a definition to find its acceleration. Little a vector is defined as delta v vector divided by delta t. So little a vector equals v vector sub 2 minus v vector sub 1 divided by t sub 2 minus t sub 1. That's plus 30 meters per second minus 0 divided by 3.0 seconds minus 0, which equals plus 10 meters per second. That acceleration might look familiar to you. It is a very special number. 10 meters per second is the acceleration due to gravity near Earth's surface. As anything falls to the ground, its velocity changes by plus 10 meters per second each second. This acceleration is so special and so useful that we give it a special symbol. Little a sub gravity is defined to be the single letter little g, and it equals very nearly 10 meters per second. For most places on Earth, little g's value is actually closer to 9.8 meters per second per second. However, 10 is such a nice round number, so very handy, that we will use g equals 10 meters per second, except when real precision is called for. Remember what little g equals 10 meters per second means. It says that objects falling near Earth's surface gain 10 meters per second of velocity every second that they fall. So, if an object falls from rest for 1 second, its velocity at the end of that first second will be 10 meters per second. If it follows for 2 seconds, its velocity will be 20 meters per second. If it follows for 3 seconds, 30 meters per second, and so on. We have just scratched the surface of acceleration's trickiness. You'll need to check the so-called tendril episodes of this RP7 video to learn more of acceleration's tricks. For example, we know what acceleration says about velocity, but what does it say about distance traveled? Also, what does negative acceleration mean? And why have we bothered to define acceleration as a vector quantity anyway? Most important of all, what causes acceleration? We found in RP2 that nothing causes velocity. Constant velocity just is. It's built into the universe. Everything has velocity relative to something. But not so for acceleration. Speed and velocity are relative quantities, but acceleration is more absolute. What causes an object to accelerate? We'll begin to answer this crucial question as we come to understand the holy of holies in mechanics, Newton's second law of motion. That's what's up next in RP8, Radical Physics Taproot episode number 8. Hang on.